So as we have a high divorce rate in the United States, actually many children grew up without having both parents. Recent study shows, especially among African Americans, only 33% grew up having both parents. So many children are growing up not having both parents, but they do grow up with the pets. So when this is interesting, when children are interacting with their pets, actually their brain works very similar way when they are interacting with their parents. So this oxytocin is the one of the neurotransmitter, neuropeptide, the small chemical in the brain. The oxytocin is frequently associated with the maternal bonding or forming attachment. The oxytocin level is very similar when they are interacting with their pets, also when they are interacting with parents. So here, I am not saying your pet can be a replacement of the parent. However, I want to point out that for many children, their pet could be their earliest playmate. So through play, those young children can learn so many important skills, such as being patient, communication skills, taking responsibility. So they can develop so many of those important social skills. So maybe having a pet could be extremely beneficial for children, especially who are growing up in this tough, challenging, complex society. So let me talk about my background. So past almost two decades, make me feel like old, I have been studying about the relationships between children and animals. So I would like to acknowledge one professor who inspired me to study in this field. He is one of the most respected scholars in this field, Dr. Frank Ashion. He's from the University of Denver. So I have a great opportunity to learn from him for many years. I was his research assistant, then started collaborating my own research with him. So we published many book chapters and academic articles together. Some of the books was translated into different languages, such as Japanese or Italian. So, but as you may see here, our focus is a little bit different. Our focus was the more deviant, more negative, dark side of the human nature. So instead of studying about how animals help young children's development, we were studying about how children are abusing their young friends. How children are abusing their pets and so on. So some of the books is very depressing. Also, it gets even worse. It's very thick and heavy. So if you have a sleep disorder such as insomnia, that's a great book to read. So I gave a copy to my husband, but I knew he's not gonna read, so I put money, but my money is still in there. So that book became my saving account. So as I say, I was studying about children who abuse, who intentionally hurt or kill animals. Usually when I study their background, they are often from abusive family or even growing up in a domestic violence home. So here, most of these social issues, child maltreatment, elder abuse, domestic violence is often interconnected. Meaning, if you find one victim, such as child abuse victim, you're gonna find some other victim in elder abuse, elder maltreatment or domestic violence. So in late 90s, I was in part of this research team studying about the relationships with the pet abuse in the domestic violence home. So we interviewed with the women who are in a domestic violence shelter. What we found was almost 71% of the women reported their abusive partner actually threatened to hurt or kill their pets. From here, most of the cases, their children were exposed to those animal cruelty. Sad thing is half of them are trying to stop it. Many children try to save their pets. So this study was replicated by some other researchers in different countries. So this was the same study in Australia. They also found very consistent findings. So among non-abused women, they didn't report any of the animal abuse case at home. But among women who were victims of domestic violence, many of them reported, yes, my partner used some, tried to kill our pets or even kill our pets. Sometimes domestic violence perpetrator use pet as an reason, or sometimes use as a tool, if you leave, I'm going to kill your pet. So many women actually stayed in that relationships to protect their pets. So for a moment, I want to think about how these young children will grow up in this domestic violence home. As you can see, there's a domestic violence case. By the way, this is a drawing by a victim of the domestic violence. So he wrote, this is my stepdad, this is mom, this is my pet. So as you can see, the abuser, abusive partner, are trying to kill the pet. So often in the domestic violence home, there are animal abuse also going on. As you can see, this is also child abuse, right? Emotional abuse. Two-thirds of the such animal abuse was caused and perpetrated by the domestic violence battlers. The sad thing is, one-third of the cases, their child is the one who killed the animals. One of the psychologists, Albert Bandura, said, children observe, then learn. Those children witnessing animal abuse cases, actually they are 8 times more likely to abuse animals. The same as some other types of abuse, not only emotional abuse. This is a study conducted by Frederick and Ashion. So this is the data, this is the children who never been abused. So among them, almost 5%, 4.7% abused their animals. Among the children who were physically, sexually abused, it gets even bigger. So this is significant, because usually their behavior never stops right there. Usually they increase the aggression when they grow up. As they physically getting bigger, stronger, they tend to choose more socially valued animals as a victim. So sometimes they start with the insect, rat, cat, dog, then humans. So there is a strong relationships, development of these aggression. The study shows 45% of the school shooter, also 48% of the rapist, 52% of the aggressive violent criminals had histories of animal abuse. You're gonna see the same relationships, childhood animal abuse and later violence in cross-culturally. Same in Japan, in Europe. Also, you're gonna see the same behavior among the children who are growing up in challenging situations. So this is a picture from the refugee camp in Cambodia. So as you can see, even this child, even though he's not abusing, he's still smiling, accepting these behaviors, deviant behaviors. Over 100 years ago, Sigmund Freud already talked about we have to be careful of such behaviors, because that's the strongest, earliest predictor of their future development of psychopathological behaviors. So today, American Psychiatric Association included cruelty to animal as one of the symptoms of conduct disorders. This conduct disorder is one type of psychological disorders among youth. This is being diagnosed conduct disorder is one of the requirements to be diagnosed antisocial personality disorder in adulthood. Another study shows 40% of the childhood conduct disorder actually develop into antisocial personality disorder. Maybe some of you refer antisocial personality disorder as a psychopath, like serial killer and so on. So we all know early intervention is very important. We have to stop those small behaviors earlier, before the behavior develops. So these are the paintings by children who are from abusive homes. As you can see, these students say, my dad was shooting my pet, and so on. It's extremely disturbing. So I was thinking, if study shows becoming aggressive, abusive toward animals lead to their future violent behavior toward humans, maybe we can teach young children to be nice to animals. That's going to prevent their development of psychopathology and aggression toward humans. I also thought by promoting their empathy toward animals, maybe this empathy could transfer to humans. So I conducted a study over 10 years ago in Japan. I went back to Japan with the help with many people, such as Ochinomizu University, Dr. Mihoko Nakagawa, Japan Veterinarian Association. We invited over 1,200 students who are second to fifth grades from nine different elementary schools. Then we give a guinea pig. So half of the students got guinea pig to take care of, then other half of the students didn't get any pets. So here, actually, let me share a little bit of information. One of the reasons why I went back to Japan to conduct this research was, at that time, pet ownership was extremely low in Japan. It's been changing. So I wanted to exclude the effect of having pet at home. So pet ownership at that time was almost 10%, 10 to 15%. So it was very rare to someone to have a pet in Japan, because we live in a small place with many people, small island. So like when I was young, I was trying to be a friend with one boy because he has a dog. So that's why I decided to go back to Japan and give a guinea pig. So half of the students got a guinea pig, then they were taken care of in the classroom settings, actually. Then I measure their empathy throughout the year. So this is a classroom looks like. So I provided 5 to 6 different guinea pigs in a classroom. Then students were taking turns to take them home during the weekends or holiday. Also, we had many veterinarians who helped us in this project, and they were making sure our guinea pigs are happy and healthy. Also, they taught us, provided humane education, basically teaching young children how to take care of guinea pigs. So I measure their empathy. So I only would like to highlight the one of several significant findings because of the limited time I have in this presentation. But if you are interested in this research, please email me. I will share my email address at the end, then I can provide whole report. So I measured their empathy using survey. I was asking about questions about their attitude, human attitude toward animals. So what I found was students who had a guinea pig in the classroom significantly increased on their score measuring empathy compared to students who didn't have a guinea pig in the classroom. Then next, I measured whether their empathy toward the animals were correlated with the empathy toward humans. So I ran the correlational coefficient, it's a statistics to see how these two different variables are related. So usually, this R.5 means that there is a moderate relationship. That's how we interpret in psychology. So 0.5 is a moderate relationship. Seems like empathy toward animals are correlated with empathy toward humans. Then some other finding was the student who had a guinea pig showed higher pro-social behaviors, more likely to show pro-social behaviors, such as helping other students, helping elderly people, and also even their social skills improved. Then I also asked their teachers to measure the engagement level among students. Then all the teachers reported, seems like the students increase in their engagement level meaning how they are interacting with their classroom pets, taking care of classroom pets, and so on. I am very sure, as an instructor, having those classroom pets in the classroom must be an external extra work to do for many teachers. But actually, I would like to mention that all teachers actually asked me, can I do the same project again, because it was so beneficial. I was actually worrying about maybe I was asking too much because all teachers are busy. Then now I'm asking, please have a guinea pig in the classroom. So, but they all agree I would like to do it again. So, that's nice. So after this study, I often get these questions. So I read their books. Seems like having guinea pig are very beneficial for young students. Do we have to have a guinea pig? So here, yes, they are so cute. But I have to share, one of the reasons why we use the guinea pig is that first, we have to make sure animals are happy in the research, right? I don't want to abuse animals in my research. So we had to consider which types of pet would be the best in the classroom settings. Some animals are not good with the classroom settings. They can be easily stressed out. So in the end, we chose guinea pig to take care of in the classroom settings. But at the same time, we had many veterinarians who were checking how the guinea pigs are doing, and so on. So also, I would like to share, there are so many studies investigating which types of pet would be best for our health. There's not much difference, actually. Even having fish will lower your blood pressure. So you don't have to have a dog. Dogs are cute, but yeah. Yeah, there was an expression, if you want to have a friend, have a dog, right? So, but yeah, it doesn't matter whether you have a dog, or a snake, or a guinea pig, and so on. Then another question I often get is that, so do we have to have a pet? I have a kid. After the study in Japan, I was so convinced, yes, you should have it because it's so good and so on. But then I came back to the United States, then I moved on. I started doing another research. Again, I go back to the dark side of the psychology. That time I was interviewing with the youth offenders who committed serious crime, like hurting other people and so on. What I found was those youth offenders who committed serious violent crimes, they all had a pet when they are young. So I got confused. So I thought having pets will facilitate their empathy. But here, there are those kids who committed serious crimes. So I have to think about what's the empathy? What's the critical component? So I think empathy is that you should be able to take perspective of someone else, your friends, to understand how the person is thinking, feeling. But nowadays, maybe with the advance of the technology, I am very sure many of you spend so much time with technology, like phone, and so on. So we are maybe losing some opportunities to interact face-to-face with your friends. So I found some great examples. I'm sure some of you do the selfie, taking picture like this. Those people look very nice, but something is wrong. So like this. So looks very nice people, even kids. So maybe we can be so absorbed in ourselves sometimes too much. Technology is very convenient, but at the same time, it is true we are missing opportunity to interact with someone else face to face.